That's one way not to be nervous.
Hello, hello.
Yes, Mallory.
So make sure you keep it close to your mouth. Yes. Okay, guys, I hope y'all enjoyed your fat-made pizza and your little side of healthy salad and veggies. Right now, this will be our last long question and answer. Megan's gonna come up unexpectedly, she didn't know, to talk about you a little bit. But right now, I just want to let y'all know that Mallory has been, over the past couple of months, which she'll definitely share with you, the Lord has been doing a lot in her life. So like I told y'all last night, I knew that she needed to be up here. And she's not gonna, she has prayerfully thought all of this out, and God is gonna speak through her. So y'all pray that she is just not nervous, because she is awesome and gonna do, and she's gonna speak well. And just listen to what she's gonna share about prayer. And so here's Mallory. Hi. Okay, so first thing I wanna talk about, tell us a little bit about yourself.
I sent Jessica a very specific question that she was supposed to ask. So, grew up here my whole life. I went to Calvary for 13 years. My favorite story about Jessica is that she is so much older than me. That's my favorite story. Okay. We went to school together, but like she wouldn't talk to me because she is too good for me. Like she's older and I was so little, she wouldn't talk to me. But anyways, I grew up in a wonderful Christian home. My mother prayed for us, which is what kind of is going to lead into where I am today. She used to pray every day on the way to school. I can't even look at her because she's sitting right there. That we would be overcomers and not overcome. That we would remember that greater is he that's in me than he that is in the world. And that God would put a thorny hedge of protection around us, that the fiery darts of Satan would not penetrate. She prayed that every day for us, and it is, you're going to see the fruit of it in my life. My dad, I like to use the verse in, not sure where it is, but it says that God planted him on the cornerstone, and that's my father. He is the cornerstone. I'm 30 years old, and several weeks ago, I called my dad at the busiest season of his life, and I said, "Dad, I need you to walk outside, and I need you to talk to me." And he got up, and he went outside, and he gave me Jesus. And that's what I can say about my dad. I came to the Lord when I was 5 years old. He became real to me at 12. And when I was 17, Job 121 came to life in me. So that he gives and he takes away, but blessed be the name of the Lord. And that was the first time God asked me to step out in faith, and he gave back to me. The first time that prayer really radiated in my life was David. I heard a sermon that said, if you want something specifically, ask God for it. And so that's what I did. For about 6 months of my life, I prayed that God would give me, in 1 Samuel 16:18, it says, a man of valor, a man of war, prudent in speech, a man of good presence, and the Lord is with him. And that's what I prayed. And David is every bit that man. He is a man of valor, a man of war. He speaks well. He has a very strong presence about him, and God is with him, and he's a great man of faith. I really look up to David to be a faithful follower of Jesus. We have two beautiful girls, Abigail and Nana, and they're the life of our house. We have a great time. So,
okay, so define your faith up until recently, and how God has revealed himself to you.
I guess up until a few months ago, I've always known the Lord. I've always followed the Lord. I have known that God loved me, and I have loved God. I've watched him genuinely save David from death in the war. I have watched David start a company in the worst economy that has ever existed, and God rise out of it. I prayed for him that God would do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think in David Downey Holmes, and that's exactly what God has done. So I have seen God do that. But Romans 8:11 says, "And the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He raised Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through the spirit who lives in you." And so just recently, God has really awakened me that, like, our faith is not a feeling. It's not something that we wake up in the morning and we say, "Oh, God did this for me, and I'm so happy, and I'm so wonderful." And then we wake up and we feel sad tomorrow, because feelings have no intellect. They can't drive our life. We have to stand on the truth of God's word. Proverbs 3:5 and 6 says, "Lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will keep your path straight." So you can't lean on yourself. You cannot. Your feelings don't help you. You've got to rely on God.
Okay, elaborate on the battle with the enemy in your life. So what has God been showing you through the enemy, and what's happened with that?
Yeah, so my mom asked me to watch War Room with her, and so we sat down and watched. If you haven't watched that movie, it's a wonderful movie. And then David and I went on the marriage retreat, and Pam talked about that in your life, there is an enemy, and he's talking to you all the time. And she talked about how her and Keith would walk, and that Keith wouldn't be talking to her, and she was like, "I'm just going to stand here, and I'm just going to wait for Keith to say something to me." And I mean, like, I'm literally thinking, this is exactly what I do with David. I'm like, I sit there completely quiet, and I'm like, "Okay, Lord, if David likes me, he'll talk to me." And, like, she said, "We're making agreements with Satan. We are listening to his lies. David doesn't not talk to me because he doesn't love me. He just genuinely has nothing to say." Like, I went somewhere with someone, and they talked the whole time, and I came home, and I was like, "Thank God you don't talk. I need to talk. Like, you cannot say anything." So it's very easy to believe the lies of Satan. So we came home from this retreat, and the enemy became very evident around me. Like, I saw where Satan was telling me lies, that he was manipulating me. And I just said, enough is enough. And so in 2 Corinthians 11:14, turn there, it says that, "And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an enemy of the as an angel of the light." Mm-hmm. And then in 2 Corinthians 10:3, it says, "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not wage war with the flesh." So as I'm reading these things, and then we start a Bible study that says in Ephesians 5:12, it says, "For our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and the principalities of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms." So now I'm looking at my life and I'm going, okay, where is Satan? And what is Satan and what is God? Like, I'm thinking about all these things and I'm like, okay, David and I have some dissension between us. You know, like, we can feel this argument going on. And I'm like, wait, is that from God, or is that Satan telling me lies? Like Pam said, am I making agreements with Satan about things that aren't even true? And so I had gotten so discouraged by all these lies and all these manipulations that I forgot the promises that God had given to our family. Satan's going to show up in your life, and he showed up in mine through strained and damaged relationships. He shows up in emotional instability, mental fatigue, and physical exhaustion. He's going to take you to those places where you're like, I am so tired that I don't like anyone or anything around me. And so then you're like, then you're emotionally like crazy. I was just, Jessica always makes fun of me because I have to go to bed at 10 o'clock or I'm not a nice person. But it's because I know that if I get physically exhausted, it is a breeding ground for Satan in my life. And so I have to do that. So now that I recognize the battle, I was telling David about this and everything that I was going to share. And David told me the story. He was like, when I was in the army and we would get ready to fight, you know, I would train hard and I would know exactly what I was supposed to do, and I would dress myself in armor, know how to shoot my gun, I would know everything. But when I walked up and I kicked in that door, if I didn't know who my enemy was, he was going to destroy me. And that's exactly the way we have to look at our life. If we don't know who the enemy is, then we're going to believe everything that he has to say about us.
Well, I love also, you know, one thing that I know God has shown you and helped me with too is just that, you know, to remember when you are in that fight, you are maybe a fight with a friend or a fight with a parent or a fight with your husband, you know, to go, okay, I'm not fighting them. Because they are loved, I love them, but I'm fighting the enemy. You know, to be able to, in that moment, go, okay, take a step back. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, the Lord really showed you that, that you were learning that I'm not fighting my husband. Mm-hmm. I'm fighting the enemy. And to go to war on their behalf. And I think that was one thing that was really big that you shared. So after acknowledging the enemy in your life, what has God called you to do?
After in Ephesians 6, after I saw that my battle was not against flesh and blood, and then he gave me everything that I needed to fight this battle, Ephesians 6:18 says, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and with all supplication. So at this point, God's like, get on your knees and pray. Look to me to answer and to fight this enemy for you. So after God has given us everything to fight, he says, here's how you fight. You pray, and you ask God to fight for you. You get up there in the heavenly realms. You know, it reads that our battle is in the heavenly realms. That's where Jesus is. So if we can get up there and we can pray with Jesus, you know, they said it the first thing, I don't want to fight for God. I want to fight with God. So get up there with him and pray with him. Call on him to move on your behalf. So now I'm in this place where I'm not just like asking God this long list of requests in my life, like do this, do that. I'm like petitioning to the heart of God, saying, God, I want my heart to look like yours, and this is what your scripture says about that. You know, we have a lot of homes for sale right now, and so I'm like looking in scripture and I'm going, what does Jesus say? Jesus says, I will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory. So when Satan comes in, he puts that fear in my life where I'm like, oh my gosh, what are we going to do? We're never going to do this. You know, we got all this money. Everyone says, spec homes will ruin you. You'll never make it. And so I'm like, no, God said he will supply all I need according to his riches and glory. So I'm like taking the lies of Satan and I'm stamping God's promises over them.
That's
and saying,
right.
You have no stronghold here.
Amen. So what has the fruit of the prayer been like in your life?
Yeah, I told Jessica, I was like, Jessica, me and Priscilla Shire are soul sisters. Like, if you have watched her, you know, videos, I told Jessica, I was like, I'm going to do a Bible study. And then we started doing Priscilla Shire's study. I was like, she stole my thunder. You know? Like, but she says in that prayer is Satan's kryptonite. And I have seen that so true in my life. When the, you know, the fear, the anxiety, the physical exhaustion, those things that Satan uses in your life come in and resonate in me. When I get down on my knees and I pray God's scripture back to the Lord, I begin to see Satan literally crumbling around me. Like, he is moving away from me. And I'm not saying that he's not going to come back, because he is. Because he is after God's people. And especially those of us who are calling to him. He's after us. So he's going to come back, but I'm just going to throw my kryptonite right back out at him. It says, She also says that prayer is the mechanism that brings the power of God into our existence. We have to remind ourselves that Satan's going to try to tell you who you are. You know, like the study says, you know, he's going to call on your insecurities. He's going to tell you you're not good enough. But we have to tell Satan who he is. And Satan is powerless. He's been embarrassed. He's unarmed. He's overruled. And he's already been destroyed. Jesus already took the victory. So, yeah, he's going to come after you because he knows in the end, you win. In the end, Jesus wins.
That's right.
So, for me, the victory has been peace. Philippians 4, 6 through 8. If you want to turn there, it's a really great place. It says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And then I love what he says right here. He says, and then the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. He says, you know, if you're in that battle, you get down there and you pray with me, and I'm going to give you that peace. And then you're going to get up and you're going to go live your life, and I'm going to guard you with that peace.
Yeah.
Not only are you going to have victory right now on the floor, you're going to have it in your life. So that's been it. And then I've also felt the weight of glory. I was listening to the Prices. They gave their testimony at the church, and Keith said right before they went up there, he was like, the glory of God is a weight upon you. And as I've been praying and giving the Lord these situations, these experiences in my life, I have felt the weight of him all around us. I mean, even David said yesterday when we were out, he said, you are different. And he said, I feel it all around me. I feel your prayers. I feel it. And you are changed, but we are changed. So
one other thing is kind of share how, you know, you're not going to have, I mean, we're supposed to be praying without ceasing and praying all the time. But what happens when you don't see that prayer, that answered prayer happen right then? And then what about looking for those small victories every day? Because you've been really good lately with that, with prayer, like, okay, yeah. God answers this really, and I'm going to find, you know, victory in this little piece. It might not be something big, but I'm going to stand on it.
Yeah, like I said, we have these houses for sale, and, you know, God just keeps giving us hope. He keeps bringing people to come and look at them, and I just look at that, and I say, okay, God, that's your hope. I'm going to stand on that today. And in Jeremiah 29:11, it says, you know, first God, and we all know it, he says, for I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you, to give you hope, and to give you a future. But after that, right after that, we often look past it. It says, and then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And that's where I am. I have sought Jesus with my whole heart, and he has found me. I guess the big thing is that I don't want to live my life wounded. I want to live my life as a warrior. John 10:10 says, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come to give you life and give you life abundantly. And I don't want to leave you thinking that the victory, like this life abundantly, is answered prayer. Because it isn't always going to be that. I mean, we've been praying for months that these houses would sell. Me and Jessica even marched, Jessica, we'd make fun of her. She marched around them, you know, and we've anointed them with oil. We've prayed over them. We've said, this is the Lord's. But today, as I was driving by them, they are consequently in the same subdivision that we live in. And so every day I have to drive by them and think, Lord, what are you doing in our life? You know? And so I was driving by them today, and I just remembered several years ago when David got started, I drove past this new subdivision, and every day I would pray, God, just let him do that. Just just let him build homes. That's what he wants to do. You want to give him desires of his heart, just let him do that. Let him build homes. And so this morning as I was driving by, I'm thinking, I can look at these houses as a burden. I can look at them as a burden. Or I can look at them as the answered prayer, as a seed that I planted years ago that now God is saying, look and see that the Lord is good. And so instead of looking at them as burdens, I've chosen to look to them as victory. So I wanted to end with this quote from Priscilla Shire, because I love her. And it says, when we stand firmly on the truth of God as revealed in His Word, when His truth is at the core of our existence, truth flows to every aspect of our life. All the movements and activities bear witness to the power of God at work in you. And I kept thinking about that. I was like, I'm praying for Dave, and I'm praying for these houses, and I'm praying for, you know, my children. I am the one that's getting all of the greatness. I'm like, they're getting it too, but I am getting it. I am the one receiving it. I am receiving the power. They become the beneficiary to divine power and wisdom. Your firm confidence not only gives you holy courage, but also spiritual muscle to carry out what He has called you to do. So even when you're facing a challenge, you can still feel the full weight and the wind of God's Spirit reverberating behind you. So, you know, even in the battle raging on, He's right there with you. He's fighting with you.
One question I have for you that I know we have talked about before is when you, back when the Lord was calling you to a life of prayer, which I think He's called each of us to, that's something that is a must to fight. And but one thing that I love that He said, you know, He's called me to pray for my family and for those around me and for the world, and being okay with that. And we, you know, just kind of expound on that a little bit on how.
Yeah, I told Jessica that, like, you know, it's easy to look at the people around you and think my calling just isn't enough. You know, like we watch these women, and you know, obviously, you know, I'm excited about what God's doing in my life, and yeah, I'd love to get up there and share. You know, so you're looking at your life going, yeah, my calling isn't that, but the calling that God has given me is to pray for my family, and not just like to genuinely say to people, like Jessica will say, you know, hey, can you pray about this? To not just say, okay, I will, but like to genuinely petition again to the heart of God on Jessica's behalf, like calling on the Spirit of God to get rid of Satan so that she can hear clearly what God's speaking to her. So we're not just being that friend that's like, yeah, I hope Comeaway does great. But like getting down on our knees and saying, God, what do you want for Comeaway? And show me how to pray like that, you know? Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Did you go over the last question, or am I good?
I think I did.
I think you did, but I was just making sure. Is there anything else that you want to close with? Just
yeah, that like we went, my mom watched the kids, and we listened to this speaker speak, and I've heard him, I think I listened to him 100 times, and it was really funny because I have heard his testimony over and over. Whenever Dave and I started the company, I used to listen to it all the time because it was just an encouragement about finances and things like that. And he came up to me after it was over, and he goes, did I leave anything out? And I was like, well, you did, you know? And so, like, I knew his testimony even better than he did. But as he was praying, when he got up there to pray, he said this. He said, move our eyes to the kingdom so that we can see what you're up to. And I think that's what prayer does. I think that's what God has revealed to me, is that, you know, if we get down on our knees and we spend that time just listening, calling on His promises, calling, getting rid of Satan, resist the devil and he must flee from you. So resisting him, listening to God, we do get to get up there in the kingdom and see what He's up to. So.
And I'd love to just finish with just prayer.
Yeah.
Generally, Father God, thank you so much for this testimony, and I thank you so much for this friend, God, that has taught me so much. Lord, I thank you for showing up in her life in such a big, big way, God, because through prayer, that is where everything happens. And I thank you for those reminders that we forget about in this busy world. And we think other things are more important. But the one thing you desire the most is a relationship with us. And that comes through talking with you and spending time in your presence, Lord. God, I just pray for Mallory, Lord. You have called her to a life of prayer and you've called her to other things, Lord. And I pray in Jesus' name that you will fulfill what you have started in her life and in David and their family's life. God, I just pray blessings over them. God, I pray for protection, and I continue to pray favor on them, God, that you will sell those houses in Jesus' name. God, I do pray that you will just give her other places that she can share what you've done in her life, God. Because, Lord, through our testimony and through giving you glory is where lives are changed, Father. And thank you so much for each one of our testimonies. And God, I just pray that this touches each one of us today, Lord, that we will step out into a life of prayer. If we have become dead to it, Lord, I pray that you will just renew us and give us a fresh outtake on what prayer is like and what we should be doing. God, just bless Mallory and David and their family and just use them according to your will. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.